Hello friends, I'm Dr. Swinder Singh from Punjab University, Chandigarh. In continuation to earlier talk, I'll discuss about the function and role of municipal committees. As we discussed earlier, there is a difference of nomenclature. In some states, these are called municipal committees. In some other states, these are called councils. And in some southern states, and in general also, they are all labeled as municipalities. Now, this urban local bodies, as far as their history goes, during the British period, there was a system of urban local government which was developed in India, and it started with the municipal corporation, first municipal corporation, which was established in 1687 in Madras. Thereafter, after a few years gap, three municipal corporations were established in Bombay, Madras and Calcutta. And then slowly and slowly in cities, there was a demand for municipal committees, and Britishers also wanted to hand over the dealing of certain local affairs to local people. It was their political motive also, it was administrative compulsion also to hand over the tackling of local problems and providing of local services to local people. Although during the British period, these were not democratic bodies. There was elected element was very much limited, and it was only after the recommendation of Lord Ripon that a thinking towards this side was started. Lord Ripon's resolutions were passed in 1882, although its implementation immediately was poor, but slowly and slowly there was a thinking that there should be local bodies and some power of local nature may be handed over to people. And the local bodies at that time were not that democratic, only very few local bodies they had elected element. Now, as far as their development and growth is concerned, during British period there was a growth of urban local bodies, better growth of urban local bodies as compared to rural local bodies. But after independence, the growth of urban local bodies, these municipalities and corporations, that was not that effective or that noticeable, which was there in the case of rural local bodies. In the case of rural local bodies, a number of commissions and committees were established, and a three-tier Panchayati Raj system was established after the recommendation of Balwant Rai Mehta Committee. But as far as municipal corporations and committees are concerned, they kept on working on the same pattern where the Britishers left them since at the time of independence. Although some elected element was introduced in a better way after independence, there was no entry in the constitution as far as setup of municipal bodies are concerned. Only the word municipal was used in some of the articles. Broadly, we can say that there was no constitutional status for these urban local bodies and also for rural local bodies. And this local body remained the state subject, and it depended upon the whims and wishes of the political leaders how to set up these local bodies and how to run these local bodies. Now, it was the pressure of certain committees and commissions and certain academicians and certain other public leaders that there was a pressure for revival of local bodies, particularly the rural local bodies. And that pressure worked for the passage of 74th Amendment also, along with 73rd Amendment for rural local bodies, to provide constitutional status to urban local bodies. Before that, the position of urban local bodies were very miserable. These were called as the dens of corruption, mismanagement, misappropriation funds was there, poor delivery of service was there, and people were not at all satisfied. Their resources were very poor. Their elections were very irregular. As we can note that in Himachal, for 20 years there were no elections for municipal bodies. And the same is the case with some other states also. We can find instances where the elections were held after a gap of very long period, and these bodies were virtually made undemocratic bodies. There was no self-government, it was only a unit of state government in most of the cases. It was only after the passage of 73rd and 74th Amendment that these bodies became really democratic bodies, and at the same time more functions, more powers and more systematic setup with uniform term of 5 years that was added after 74th Amendment. Now, as far as the role of urban local bodies is concerned, we all know a number of problems which our cities are facing with the influx of population, with increasing population and with increasing migration of population. There are a variety of problems are there as far as urban areas are concerned. These may range from providing of local services, tackling of problem of municipal waste, providing of services such as water supply, electricity supply, maintenance of roads, naming of streets, cleaning of streets, disposal of dead animals, besides some routine functions of registration of births and deaths, naming of streets and allotment of certain parking areas, market areas and all that. There are some routine functions. And then they, what to talk about developmental functions, it is only very few local bodies that those who are really focusing on developmental functions. So if we go by the list of the functions of municipalities, we can again divide the functions into two categories, like we divided the functions of a municipal corporation in obligatory functions and discretionary functions. If we compare with the municipal corporation, there is a variation, there is a little difference as far as list of obligatory functions is concerned and list of discretionary functions are concerned. Since the municipal corporation is the highest body with more functions, more powers and more finances, more responsibilities have been assigned to municipal corporations as compared to municipal committees. For instance, providing of local transport or local health services or establishment of municipal hospitals or municipal schools, it can be a part of obligatory functions in the case of municipal corporation, but these are not the part of obligatory functions of a municipal committee. These may be a part of discretionary functions of a municipal committee, but in actual practice, these obligatory functions are not really being taken up by the municipal committees. Only very few selected municipal committees, they are for the implementation or taking up of these discretionary functions. Now, as far as the role of municipal bodies are concerned, or municipalities or municipal committees are concerned, we know there is a long list of functions they are to perform. But if we look at their real performance or the role and real working is concerned, even after the passage of 74th Amendment Act, although there are now regular elections with the establishment of State Election Commission, and they are getting more or better resources after the establishment of state finance commissions, still their position is not that good. That is, it is not that comfortable. They are not performing, or rather they are not in a position to perform all these functions or the required or desired functions. Very few municipalities are there which are actually performing all these functions. But in most of the cases, only bare minimum functions are being performed by the municipalities. As far as developmental functions are concerned, again, very few municipalities, they are actually performing developmental functions or welfare functions. Now, the problem is, as pointed out earlier, the problem is that one is that of finances, limited finances which these bodies Second is, they are not in a habit. There is not much practice, there is not much pressure on these bodies to actually perform which they are required to perform. Even if they have finances, there is a lot of corruption, there is a lot of mismanagement, malpractices are there. So what we require is what we nowadays listen a lot, that is good governance. In the case of municipalities, in the case of corporations, or in the case of all the public bodies, which we require good governance. And in fact, these elements of good governance are being introduced to local bodies also as a part of some developmental functions which are to be implemented by the local bodies. For instance, this GNNRUM, Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Program, that was introduced, and then there is Atul Program. Some elements of good governance are there in the implementation of these programs. It is mandatory that if these programs are being implemented properly and if certain parameters are being met by the local bodies, only then grants are released by the government. And this is something very good, and this will introduce some good element of governance as far as the working of these bodies are concerned. Along with this, there must be some pressure from local people, local population, local leaders. They must work in collaboration with these municipal bodies. Here I would like to repeat some of the elements of good governance, and these good governance, which are also a part of, as I told you earlier, the part of the developmental programs for urban development. And these elements, as most of us know, are transparency, that is openness in working, rule of law, that is to work in accordance with rules, not by the whims and imaginations of people, but work according to rules, transparency, openness, then good management, decentralization, people's participation, responsiveness. So friend, I hope you enjoyed the talk. Along with this, I would like to emphasize on certain things. These talks are never complete. There may be some shortcomings in it, there may be some good points in it. And as far as I'll be happy if you find some shortcomings and you work on that, and you try to explore your own resources wherever I have left some gaps, because everything cannot be covered in such short talks. And I would also like to emphasize that you have got some texts, and some reading material has also been referred in those texts. It's better if you go to some original books, some original works, some research works. Along with that, this particular area of municipal corporation and municipal committees is practical and live, or I would say current issues, and which affects all the citizens. I would advise you that you go for the actual working of these bodies in your own city, in your own area, in whichever state you stay, and you try to relate the theory with the practice, and you try to identify the problems which are actually there in that particular, in your own area. And that will, I think, enrichen your knowledge, and that will make you good, enlightened citizens. Thank you very much.